what a delight it is to be with you tonight and traveling in such a wonderful company. Also, we have my wife, Megan. My claim to fame in East North Carolina is I married an East North Carolina girl from Wilson, Megan Tucker Newby. So, Megan, if you would wave there, everybody. Lovely wife Alex is here with us too. So Alex, Lieutenant Governor and I share the fact that we married way over our heads. I'm just still grinning from ear to ear. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, you've got a new governor in North Carolina. That's exciting news, you know. When I think about that, tomorrow you're going to have a new lieutenant governor. You know, run, Forrest, run was pretty good, right? But tomorrow it's Lieutenant Dan. So, also, just here with Justice Martin, I mean, it's so exciting. Justice Martin got his start to his judicial career in Eastern North Carolina. And in 2 years, the current Chief Justice will have to step down because of age. I don't know if y'all knew this, but in North Carolina, we have for judges, nobody else, but for judges, we have statutory senility. You turn 72, you see how about that? And so Chief Justice Martin will be stepping down, and Justice Martin has graciously consented to run for that seat. And he will be a great Chief Justice. When I started thinking about the history of our court, And I'm reminded of one of the greatest jurists, one of the founders of the Republican Party, from here in Little Washington, here in Beaufort County, William Rodman. And I want to talk just a minute about him because I think it so fits our meeting here this evening. Before I do that, I would be remiss if I didn't thank all of y'all for your incredibly hard work that you poured into my campaign. I mean, you don't believe in miracles, try running statewide with last name Newby. I mean, being successful, you know, Scooby Dooby vote for Newby, and we get so far, I understand that. But all of y'all worked really, really hard. I was able to win in this county, and certainly in this area did very well because of your hard work, and I want to thank each of you for doing that. When I think of Justice Rodman, again, one of the founders of the Republican Party in North Carolina, he started out as a Confederate war hero, ended up as part of the Confederate government in Richmond. When the war was over, he walked from Richmond to Greensboro to surrender to the Union troops. He had a home here in Beaufort County that had been destroyed by the Union troops during the war. He, off his, the bricks on his house had been taken by his neighbors. The fruit trees that he had been taken by his neighbors. So he had a right to be a little bit upset with both sides, but he was upset with nobody. And he stood up in the floor of the Constitutional Convention in 1868, and he said, "The war that we went through was about ideas. And it's taken me a while to understand that." He said, "You folks on both sides can understand that this war ultimately became about whether all means all in the principles that Jefferson put forward in our Declaration, that all are created equal and endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights." Now, the interesting aspect of that, okay, is that it's so foundational to who we are as a nation. Certainly, Justice Rodman was absolutely dead on, not only that all means all, but in saying or in recognizing the source of those rights. You see, if somebody says, "What makes us different as a nation?" we should all be ready to say, what makes us different than 99% of the world throughout the history of the world is that most of the world says our rights and freedoms come from government. Government has power. They tell us what our rights are. Not so America. You see, we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all are created equal and endowed not by a government or a constitution or a bill of rights. Endowed by our Creator with certain inalienable rights. Life, liberty, the pursuit of happiness. And so when Justice Rodman, in his mind, as he worked through this idea, said, all means all. It's a land of equal opportunity for everybody. And he was one of the foremost spokesmen of equality. This Southern Confederate war hero was one of the foremost spokesmen for equality throughout North Carolina during his tenure on the Supreme Court and throughout his life. Those are the kinds of values that are taught here in Eastern North Carolina. And he carried those to our state, and they have influenced. He was there. He helped draft the preamble to our state constitution that answers the question about what is the source of those rights. Our current state constitution begins this way. We, the people of the state of North Carolina, grateful to Almighty God, the sovereign ruler of nations, for the preservation of the American Union and the existence of our civil, political, and religious liberties, and acknowledging our dependence upon God for the continuation of those blessings to us and to our posterity. We are that posterity, and by God's grace, those of you my age and older, were given incredible, unparalleled, fundamental rights and freedoms. But we have slowly allowed those to evaporate and to dissipate. And if we're not careful, one day our grandchildren will say, tell us about freedom. Tell us about liberty. Ladies and gentlemen, we can't allow that to happen. We need to understand that our nation and the fundamental principles we have are vital, not just to here, but for the world. We are a light. We're a beacon to the world of freedom and liberty. Now, the closest that we come to a democracy is through electing our state representatives and senators. We're not a democracy. The framers of our Constitution looked at democracy. They never worked. We are a constitutional republic. And so we elect capable men and women like Representative Steinberg, Senator-elect Cook, individuals who understand and appreciate the constitutional limitation on government. You see, in America, we believe our rights and freedoms are supreme. They are God-given. And the limited and sole purpose of government is to protect those fundamental rights and freedoms. Just because it's a good idea doesn't mean that they have the power to do it. What they can do is limited by this document. Representative Cook exercised that limitation, and you've rewarded him. I know as he will soon take the oath to become a senator, he will continue to respect those constitutional limitations. Now, I've wondered what his nickname's going to be. I thought about Lyndon Johnson, okay? And that, not that I would compare you to Lyndon Johnson, forgive me. You know, only the wide margin of the victory comes to mind, okay? You may recall that Lyndon Johnson, through various nefarious, underhanded kind of means, squeaked out a small victory, and so he was known as Landslide Lyndon. Now, we, on the other hand, who play by the rules always, okay? I'm just wondering if maybe it should be called Big Margin Bill. I have to say, election night, of course, I was somewhat interested in my race, I gotta admit, okay? And certainly Dan Forrest's race, you know, we kind of felt like that the governor's race was pretty well taken care of, the president's race. But statewide, the one race on election night that I was disappointed in, and quite frankly, I was in Raleigh, so I was with the folks who watched this stuff statewide. The one race statewide they were really upset about was this race, because we went to bed and the good guy hadn't won. But guess what? When they actually counted all the votes, surprise, surprise, Big Margin Bill had prevailed. Such a historic setting, such a historic courthouse. We do need to think about what are the foundational, fundamental principles of who we are as a people. Since 1776, our state constitution has reminded us that a frequent recurrence of fundamental principles is absolutely necessary to preserve the blessings of liberty. Bill Cook has demonstrated that the first question he asked is not, is this a good idea? There are a lot of good ideas out there. But the first question has always got to be, does this legislation comply with our state constitutional rights? In other words, does what this law does, is that in keeping with what we can do, or does it encroach upon these fundamental rights and freedoms? We have to have those who will safeguard those rights at every branch of government. And I'm proud that Bill Cook is one of those individuals who will do that. It's now my privilege to administer the oath of office to Senator-elect Cook. And as I do so, I want you to listen to the things that he is pledging to do, because it's not just for you. You represent all the people of his district. But it's also before Almighty God. In 1777, the very first statute passed by the General Assembly was the Oath Statute. And in General Statute 11-1, it's part of our statutory framework today, it makes it clear that when we take this oath of office, it is before Almighty God, who is omniscient, he knows all of our thoughts, and omnipotent, that he will punish those, quite frankly. It's what the statute says, that don't live up to their oath. It's a solemn occasion, but oh, what a special occasion, as we recognize that we need the help of the sovereign God to understand, to do justice, to exercise mercy, and to walk humbly with our God. Sir? If you would please place your left hand on the Bible and raise your right hand. Let's move over this one. I've got to have a right picture here. And obviously, the center of the photo should be right here, so I'll hide that. If you place your left hand on the Bible, raise your right hand. Do you solemnly swear that you will support the Constitution and laws of the United States? And do you solemnly and sincerely swear that you will be faithful and bear true allegiance to the state of North Carolina, to the constitutional powers and authorities which are or may be established for the government thereof, and that you will endeavor to support, maintain, and defend the Constitution and laws of said state, not inconsistent with the Constitution of the United States, to the best of your knowledge and ability? And do you solemnly and sincerely swear that you will faithfully discharge the duties of your office as a member of the Senate of the 2013 General Assembly of the State of North Carolina to the best of your knowledge and ability? So help you God.
I do. Thank you.